Hi, I'm Dr. Heidi Koltfarber, and I'm super excited to bring you a new series looking at CBCTs and how to interpret CBCTs for each of the different diagnostic categories. Today, we're going to be talking about benign cysts or tumors, and how do we approach that when you see something like that in a CBCT? Just a few speaker disclosures. I am the owner and managing oral maxillofacial radiologist for dental radiology diagnostics. I'm also a 3D trainer and key opinion leader. And I'm also adjunct professor of diagnostic sciences at UNC Chapel Hill and assistant professor of general diagnostic radiology at Loma Linda University School of Medicine. So let's talk about a couple of things. I always love going through cases because I think it relates so well to what we do every single day, and they're so exciting. So this particular case was sent to us, and this is the history that we were given. 39-year-old male, history of root canal treatment and retreatment. Patient is not in pain, but does report occasional drainage from the right mandible. And clinically, tooth number 29 is considered non-restorable and may need extraction. One of the things that I do want to point out when we review a CBCT is we want to look at our radiographic signs. So if you do find a lesion, these are the radiographic signs we're going to look at. So just kind of keep these in mind as we go through the case. We can see radiographic density, marginal characteristics, shape, location and distribution, size, internal architecture, and effects on surrounding tissue. So we're going to look at all of those things as we go through the lesion in the volume. So here's our volume, and we know that the patient has drainage in the right mandible and that there's a history of root canal treatment and retreatment on tooth number 29. So of course, being radiologists, we do review the entire volume, but we also do want to come and look at the particular region of interest. And one of the things that you can see is we do have a nice lesion. It appears to be extending from the distal and apical aspect of tooth number 27 to the apical aspect of tooth number 30. And we'll just zoom in on that. We're going to go ahead and measure that as well. So we always want to figure out where exactly is that contained. Okay, so easily can do that. One of the things that you will notice as well is that this lesion scallops. So yes, we do have root canal treated tooth number 29, but we have a well-defined scalloping, I'd say partially corticated hypodensity. So when we're talking about things with CBCT, we might have said radiolucency with our 2D imaging. Their CBCTs, we'll call it a hypodensity. It's hypodense to the surrounding tissues. As we're scrolling through, we can see that we don't necessarily have apical resorption. We might say there's a suggestion of it here on tooth number 28. And then, of course, you want to know, what is it doing to the mandibular canal? And from our custom section here, it looks like it's slightly displacing. We can always go to our panoramic radiograph as well. So our panoramic reconstruction. So I'm going to go ahead and create my panoramic reconstruction. I just want to compare things bilaterally and rule out any sort of asymmetry. And when I'm comparing my mandibular canal, make that a little darker, it does look like my mandibular canal is slightly inferiorly displaced. So whatever this particular item is, it's displacing the canal. I can also compare the teeth, and I can see that it's actually displacing the premolars as well when I compare it to the contralateral side. So it's telling us we do have some sort of a mass type effect in this particular area. And this helps us to decide what particular category to put it in. Now, one of the things that we do want to notice, if this was a large radicular cyst, if this was inflammation, we would have extensive amount of bony sclerosis. And we can compare that to a lesion on the other side. So the patient does have a lesion on the other side as well. Let's hop on over and take a peek at that. So this one is inflammatory in origin. It's well-defined. It's non-corticated. You're going to see that you have surrounding bony sclerosis. And that lets us know that we have a chronic inflammatory process. So we can compare these two lesions. And I think this is an excellent case to do that because we see an inflammatory lesion on one side and essentially a non-inflammatory lesion on the other side. We really don't have a lot of bony sclerosis around this one. Let's go ahead and look. This patient's been reporting drainage. Do we have a spot that we might see drainage through? Well, you have something distal to number 28, and this is a potential draining fistula tract. So we can say that perhaps that's where it's draining. We can see it right here as well. Let me turn off the lines real quickly as well. The other thing you'll notice is we do have thinning of the cortical borders. And other than just that one location, they're largely intact, even though they're thinned. And it was a fairly large lesion, but you'll notice that there's very minimal expansion when we're looking at symmetry and we're comparing one side to another. And so based on these characteristics, we are going to come up with what category we feel that this is in. And looking at it, it's not looking to be particularly inflammatory. I know he's had a root canal treatment on this tooth. Certainly when these lesions are small, they can look like a periapical lesion. But this looks to be something more, perhaps a benign cyst or tumor. The scalloping margins really tell us a lot as well. So going through our volume, we're going to jump right back into our PowerPoint and talk about what we saw. So when we look at this with our radiographic signs, we can say it's hypodense to surrounding trabecular bone. Our marginal characteristics are well-defined, partially corticated with scalloped margins. The shape, it might be irregular, but we have nice scalloped margins, a scalloping shape. Location and distribution, it's really just in one location. And what we would technically do is go through the entire CBCT and make sure that there's not another similar lesion as well, which is particularly important for this particular entity. So we can see that it does go from the apices of number 27 to number 30. We can evaluate the size in all three planes. Internal architecture, it really did not have any internal architecture. It was generally hypodense. As we would say, it was unilocular. There were no septations. There were no internal calcifications. And what were those effects on the surrounding tissues? Was, again, we had that slight tooth displacement between the premolars, slight apical root resorption on number 28, but not really a prominent thing with this particular entity. Slight inferior displacement of the mandibular canal, thinning of the buccolingual cortical borders with minimal to no expansion of those borders, and a suggestion of an oral communication. So in general, this is acting like a benign entity. It's taking the time to displace the teeth. It's not really doing a lot as far as resorption. It's not really eroding things. It's kind of taking the time to gently displace things. And so that's very important. So our category of diseases we talked about is a benign odontogenic cyst or tumor. Our number one thing would be an odontogenic keratocyst. Number two would be a radicular cyst, but we're not really thinking that it is inflammatory in origin because we didn't really see that surrounding bone sclerosis. Our third differential could be a unicystic ameloblastoma. However, unicystic ameloblastomas tend to like to resorb roots, and we did not particularly see that. So how do we manage this? If this report was sent back, it would be sent back with some management suggestions. And we'd say definitely we need a biopsy to corroborate the radiographic findings that it's an odontogenic keratocyst. And we would go ahead and request vitality testing of the surrounding teeth to determine if they've been devitalized by the size of that lesion. So when we're talking about odontogenic keratocysts, these are, if you're going to have a cyst or a tumor in the oral cavity, this is fairly common as it goes. Usually we see second or third decade of life, but it can really be at all ages. Symptoms may be none, or they might have some swelling or drainage, which this patient did have. Most common in the posterior mandible, it typically arises from the dental lamina, and it grows along that endosteal surface. And that's why we saw very minimal expansion for the size of the lesion. And it can be unilocular, it can be multilocular. There's a lot of controversy as far as what this actually is. So the World Health Organization keeps changing their mind between it being a cyst versus a tumor. And why is that? Well, it's because there's a variability in the aggressiveness of these particular entities. Some will act more like a benign cyst, but some will be a little bit more aggressive like a tumor. And they do have the possibility of recurrence. In fact, they have a fairly high recurrence rate. And so because of that, over time, this has gone back and forth between being a cyst versus a tumor. It does contain keratin, kind of a thick, yellow, cheesy material, so the oral surgeons typically know what they've gotten into once they open it up. This particular lesion, you'll notice that it's quite large, and these can be very large before they're actually recognized because they really have very minimal expansion. And so if we're looking at this particular case, this was a multilocular lesion, and we can see that when we're comparing from one side to another, very minimal expansion for that extensive size of the lesion. That kind of it tends to be very typical for them. They can look like many different things. They can actually look like dentigerous cysts as well if there's a tooth involved. So if you're looking at something and you're considering a dentigerous cyst, you would also put odontogenic keratocyst on your differential. It can look like a periapical lesion, which it obviously did in this case, and a root canal treatment was done and a retreatment was done. Sometimes it can look like a simple ameloblastoma, a simple bone cyst or ameloblastoma. And it can even look like a lateral periodontal cyst when it's very, very small and between the roots of the teeth. So it can look like a host of different things, especially when it's in its smaller sizes. How is this managed? Typically with enucleation. They do need to go ahead and clean it out and make sure that the lining is completely removed on this. There is a high recurrence rate, as I stated before. All right. And of course, we always want to determine where the mandibular canal is located and what it's doing to the mandibular canal, as well as the associated structures. Now, there is a version of this, which is called basal cell nevus syndrome. This is a more aggressive form of odontogenic keratocysts where you get multiple OKCs. You see this in a little bit younger age group. And with this, these kiddos will have not only multiple of these OKCs or odontogenic keratocysts, but they'll also have basal cell carcinomas, rib abnormalities, and that sort of thing. So it's a whole syndrome that can go with having multiple of these lesions. So if you are looking at a case and you see multiple lesions, particularly in a younger individual, we're going to start to think about basal cell nevus syndrome. I hope you enjoyed the discussion for today. I know I really did. I really appreciate your time. If you enjoyed this content, please go ahead and like and subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you can be notified of future videos. And I look forward to reviewing another case with you in the future. Have a great day. Bye.